Hello and welcome to Winsskins, a program featuring reflections on the lives of the saints and the sacred scriptures, along with a variety of topics and issues from a Catholic perspective. I'm your host, Father Jim Korda. Our show is sponsored by the annual Bishop's Appeal, the Catholic Communication Campaign, and St. Paul's Catholic Books and Gifts, a division of the Society of St. Paul. On our show today, I will interview Father Joe Witmer on the 75th anniversary of the Diocese of Youngstown. We will also hear more about the lives of all the saints and the readings for this 30th Sunday in Ordinary Time. That and more on Winsskins. And now I will speak with our friends from the Western Reserve Living Center of Trumbull County. With me is Cindy Casterline, who is the Youth Transition Coordinator for the Western Reserve Independent Living Center in Trumbull County. Cindy, welcome to Winsskins.
Thank you.
I know that you work very closely with the youth, especially ages 14 through 21, mainly high school kids. What is it that you'd like to share with us that's an important program that you have just undertaken at the center?
We're actually going into the high schools and doing self-advocacy classes. This is very important. It teaches the kids to speak out, especially the main group of kids that we talk to are kids with disabilities. So most of them have IEPs. So we talk to them a lot about going in and having a voice in their education, speaking up for things that they need, you know, just speaking up for themselves.
And I know that part of the other training is a pre-employment. Why is it so important for a youth with disabilities to have that wherewithal to enter the workforce?
Well, youth with disabilities, people with disabilities have a harder time getting a job, as you know. So it's important for them to have that advantage. We're going to help them with their resumes and professionalism and even just trying to figure out what career that they would like to have and how to get there.
Is this a relatively new program with the Western Reserve Living Center, or is this a program that has been around for a while?
No, it's brand new. We are in our second year now, so we're getting into the pre-employment this year.
What would you like to let the folks know particularly about the program and how they might be able to be helpful to the Wellness and Living Center?
Well, they could definitely call us up if they feel like you need any of those independent living skills, or we can do one-on-one sessions. We do go through the schools for this program, but you can definitely go through a caseworker or your teacher, and we do one-on-one sessions. So if they need a little individual training, or if you do homeschooling, something like that, call us up and we can help you out with that self-advocacy and those pre-employment trainings.
Let's talk about that advocacy program again. Why is it important to be an advocate for people with disabilities? Is it sometimes because they really don't have a voice or a platform to speak out for themselves?
Yeah, absolutely. Some of the people that we deal with are nonverbal, so they can't really speak up for themselves. So we try and teach them how to be able to do that. And if not, we will do that. We will help you do that.
How important are their parents or their guardians in this process? Are they very helpful?
Yes, the support system is very important. It's one of the things that we talk about, the people in your life that they can help you, you know, with the simple things, even like making a doctor's appointment, because these youth are transitioning to adulthood and a lot of them aren't aware of how to do any of this stuff. So we try and lead them and make them think about the things that they need to do in the future.
And I know this program is in the Trumbull County area. Are you aware of other counties where this wonderful service is actually taking place as well?
Well, our unit actually services Columbiana, Ashtabula, Trumbull, and Mahoning County. So we do four counties, and all of the independent living centers in Ohio do it in different counties. So it's everywhere.
In your time with the Western Reserve Living Center, what have you learn for yourself about the importance of why you're doing what you do?
Oh, it's so important to give these kids a voice. A lot of them, like I said, the teachers, we're getting really good positive feedback from the teachers and the students. It's so important that they know that they're important, that their voice matters, and that they can speak up for themselves.
If someone wanted to get in touch with the Western Reserve Independent Living Center, how and what would be the best way to get in touch with you?
They could call us. Our phone number is 330-372-3325. You can go to www.rilc, which is W-R-I-L-C.org. We have a website there that has all our contact information and some email, or you can email us at rilc.org.
Well, Cindy Casterline, thank you so much for being with us and also for sharing this important program for the youth of these many counties in the state of Ohio. We wish you well, and we hope that this is going to be a really successful program.
Thank you.
For Winsskins, I'm Father Jim Korda. The Feast of All Saints is celebrated on Thursday. To tell us more about this holy day of obligation is Tom McCarthy. He is from St. Charles Church in Boardman.
The solemnity of the Feast of All Saints is probably Celtic in origin. The Martyrology of Ireland lists April 17th as a commemoration of all the martyrs and April 20th as the Feast of All Saints in Ireland, Britain, and the rest of Europe. In England, St. Bede's Martyrology has no mention of this feast, but in the 8th or the beginning of the 9th century, November 1st is listed as the Feast of All Saints. At Rome, the feast was celebrated with a vigil and fasting in the 10th century, but Rome borrowed from the East the date of May 13th. On the same date in 609, Pope Boniface IV dedicated the Pantheon in Rome as a church in honor of Mary, ever virgin, and all the martyrs. This feast was celebrated in the Easter season to emphasize the Paschal victory of the martyrs. We know from the Sermon of St. John Chrysostom, however, that in the Byzantine Rite, the Feast of All Saints was celebrated on the first Sunday after Pentecost. The Feast of All Saints applies not only to all canonized saints, but to all the saints that are in glory. Every person in heaven is a saint because each one has reached the perfection of charity. There are three themes in the liturgy of this feast. First, in the opening prayer, we say that we rejoice in the holy men and women every time and place, and we ask if their prayers will bring God's forgiveness and love. The first theme, therefore, is our belief in the combined intercession of the saints. In the prayer over the gifts and the prayer after communion, mention is made of the glory of the saints in which all are blessed and will share. The second theme is therefore the concept of Holy Jerusalem, which is the goal of our earthly pilgrimage. We journey in hope and with an aware of the saints' concern to help and save us. The third theme is found in the prayer after communion, where reference is made to the table of the Eucharist and the joy of the kingdom, where Jesus is Lord forever and ever. Our faith tells us that we can pass from the Eucharistic table to the eternal banquet in heaven. The significance of the feast is given in the office of the readings in a sermon by St. Bernard, which replaces the former reading from St. Bede. Clearly, if we venerate their memory, it serves us, not them. But I tell you, when I think of them, I feel myself inflamed by tremendous yearning. Calling the saints to mind inspires, or rather arouses us, above all else, a longing to enjoy their company, so desirable in itself. In short, we long to be united in happiness with all the saints. But our dispositions change. The Church of all the first believers of Christ awaits us, but we do nothing about it. The saints want us to be with them, and we are indifferent. The souls of the just await us, and we ignore them. For Winsskins, I'm Tom McCarthy.
Talking with Father Joe Witmer. In our middle segment, Father Joe, we were talking about our dialogue and relationship with the Lutheran community and the covenant that we entered into. Let's bring that back for the folks that are with us, a little history of how that started and who was instrumental in that.
Certainly. A local Lutheran layperson was on the Northeast Ohio Synod Board, and he said, "The focus of the Northeast Ohio Synod seems to be Akron Canton. Can't we do something in the Mahoning Valley that the Lutherans who are here can feel encouraged and involved in?" So Bishop Marcus Miller, this is early the year 2000, approached Bishop Tobin, and there was a luncheon. Bishop Marcus Miller asked Bishop Tobin if he would be open to having a celebration on the first anniversary of this, of the signing of that joint declaration in October, then first anniversary, 2000. Mm-hmm. Bishop Tobin said readily, "That's fine, but I think we ought to do more. I think we ought to enter a covenant with one another and commit ourselves to prayer, study, and action." The covenant was written and signed at that first anniversary celebration, and has been unfolding ever since.
And we know that in 2017, there was a significant celebration honoring the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation, but also our continued dialogue with the Lutheran Church and the Catholic community. Let's talk also about why it's important for us as priests to be involved in ecumenical dialogue. Both of us are involved with the Lutheran Commission. You have been involved with it a lot longer than I have. But in our parish work and in our community relationships, we've gotten involved with local groups, ecumenical groups, interfaith groups that have gotten together to talk about those issues that affect all of us. And also to look more at a closer union with one another. So why is it important for us as leaders, as parish leaders, community leaders, to be involved in this dialogue?
A growth in understanding is so important, because if you just think that ecumenism is nothing but not doing bad things to the other, that's pretty easy. But trying to share information, share history, share where there's changes, we could talk about Vatican II, what is promising and what are things that attention needs to be paid to as things continue to unfold. Especially in the last years since Vatican II, there's more and more exposure to ecumenism in the seminary, and therefore hopefully a little bit of confidence in making these contacts, joining a clergy association. In the Mahoning Valley, we have an association of churches, and it's not all clergy, it's lay people too. And so the more knowledge they have, the more enthusiasm they can bring.
And the Diocese of Youngstown has been involved in these organizations and community structures for years, celebrating our anniversaries together. We know that the Mahoning Valley Association recently celebrated 100th anniversary. So in celebrating these anniversaries and in continuing our dialogue with one another, what does that say about our future?
One cannot really talk about that you do this, you'll get that result. Nothing's that easy. Mm-hmm. But if you're not a player, if you're not there, if you're not listening, if you're not thinking, if you're not acting together, very little will happen. So it's a matter of if there's any prayer for, any desire for greater unity, then people must be involved.
And let's talk about that specific week of prayer for Christian unity that we celebrate as Christians every year, usually around January, and centering also around the Feast of the Conversion of St. Paul. So why is it significant for us to engage, especially during that week, not just every day, but especially during that time?
Right, it's a time to focus our attention on that. The priest, the chair of St. Peter, and then the Feast of St. Paul, 8 days later, that was the octave or the week of prayer. This was founded by a religious order who at that time was attached to the Anglican Church in England. In the United States, these Graymore friars became Catholics. And now they are the ones on behalf of the Vatican, at least in the United States, of translating and preparing the materials for the annual week of prayer. So it's a time to say, we could do it any time, but how about if we do it now? Mm-hmm. Others found there's other problems, especially in the northern part of the country, a thing called snow, that maybe Pentecost is a better time of year to do this, but find some time and getting consensus on that, that's the challenge.
It's interesting you bring that up in our last 2 minutes of our time together. I've often thought of this, that you know, when we talk about ecumenism and interfaith dialogue and relationships with other Christian communities, that we try to look at that sense of renewal and rebirth and trying to be refreshed. And what better time than Pentecost, the birthday of the church, to actually celebrate something like that? And how important and what a wonderful statement it would make if Christians together would celebrate our diversity, but also looking forward to our unity during Pentecost.
Amen.
What would you like to share with the folks very briefly about ecumenical dialogue?
It's happening at different places, at different tempos, but climb on board. A lot of information can be found at the website of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops, usccb.org. And go on to, I think it's Beliefs and Teachings, and one of the subcategories there is Ecumenical. And go under there, and you can find the different dialogues and topics that have been treated by each of the dialogues. That'll get you a little more familiarity and get your foot into the water.
Father Joe Witmer, thank you for being with us and celebrating the 75th anniversary of the Diocese of Youngstown.
Thank you.
And thank you for being with us. Have a good day. And God be with you.
To receive more information on that and other issues, and to listen to Wineskins, visit the website of the Catholic Diocese of Youngstown at www.doy.org. Stay with us. We'll be back in a moment. In 1850, a Catholic mission was established in Conneaut, making it the first organized Catholic presence in Ashtabula County. It wouldn't be until 1864 that an actual building was purchased to serve St. Mary Church. 8 years before the construction of St. Mary's Parish Church, St. Joseph Church in the city of Ashtabula was established. Parishes in Conneaut have aligned under the title of Corpus Christi Parish, and in the city of Ashtabula as Our Lady of Peace Parish. There are 11 other parishes in that county that serve over 20,000 Catholics. Congratulations, Catholic Diocese, for celebrating 75 years with pride in the past and faith in the future. Our song today is by John Michael Talbot. It is from his CD entitled Our Blessing Cup, Songs for Liturgical Celebrations.
Come, worship.
Shepherds.
just bow down and worship, bending the knee before the Lord our Maker. For we are His people, we are the flock that He shepherds. So come and worship the Lord, for we are His people, the flock that He shepherds. Alleluia. So come and worship.
Our scripture reflections for this 30th Sunday in Ordinary Time will be by Father Terry Hazel. He is pastor of St. Michael Church in Canfield.
We all know the two great commandments. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the first commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. This is the bottom line of Christianity. Love God. That's easy. Go to church, receive the sacraments, pray, love your neighbor. That's easy too. Give to the church, to the missions, give to third world countries. No problem. What's that, Lord? Neighbor. Oh, you mean my real neighbors, like the person next door. Suppose your neighbor is into heavy metal music at midnight. Suppose your neighbor continually runs into your bushes when she pulls out of the driveway at night. Suppose your neighbors are into loud and obscene arguments. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Love your neighbor as you love God. Someone's got to be kidding. There is an old Irish saying that goes like this: all neighbors are strange. It's easy enough for the Good Samaritan to love the man on the side of the road, because he did not have to live next door to him. But if that man would have been his next door neighbor, they probably would have had their share of fights, to say nothing about the conflicts between the kids. It is easy to profess love for neighbor when we are in Haiti or El Salvador or India. But let one of those neighbors migrate to the United States and move in next door, conflict begins. Whoever said charity begins at home was dead wrong. Charity does not begin at home. It begins as far away from home as possible. It is easier that way. Charity does not begin at home. It ends there, because that's where it's most difficult. The irascible neighbor next door, the fussy old lady behind you, the troublemaker across the street, the kids who litter your lawn, that's where charity ends, at the property line. It is a fact that, oftentimes, the most difficult people to be charitable to are the ones closest to you, the ones you see every day. Sometimes, the most difficult people to be charitable to are the ones you live with, the ones you love. God summarized the Old Testament laws into two: love God and love your neighbor. It appears very easy, But actually, he was throwing us a curveball, knowing full well that most of us would strike out. What Jesus was saying is that we must treat the people who live next door and even the people who live in our own homes the same way we would treat God. And that is tough. Charity does not begin at home, it usually ends at home. It is much easier to be charitable for those who live far away than it is for those who live in our own home. If we are charitable to those at home, then you can be sure we have long been charitable to those far away as well. In conclusion, there are very few people throughout the year that have such a practical application in our daily lives, and perhaps very few that are more difficult to apply. Those wonderful people who we love so much and who drive us up the wall, we have to treat them with love, just like we love God and ourselves. Jesus said to him, "You shall love your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the first commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Bottom line, Christianity. Amen. For Winsskins, this is Father Terry Hazel.
Every day that we live, we are invited to follow Jesus anew. No matter what our limitations or impediments may be, Jesus calls us to follow Him. Sometimes, even when we don't realize it, we are being called. Consider how God is calling you today. Wineskins is made possible by the annual Bishop's Appeal, the Catholic Communication Campaign, and St. Paul's Catholic Books and Gifts. The program is produced by CTNY, the Catholic Telecommunications Network of Youngstown. I'm your host, Father Jim Korda, wishing you a blessed Sunday, a safe week, and remember that this coming Thursday is the Feast of All Saints, a holy day of obligation.
What have you done for your marriage today?
I gave my wife a hug this morning. I told her I love her.
I did her hair this morning. I think it looks pretty good.
I cooked my husband's favorite breakfast.
I bought her an orchid.
What have I done for my marriage today? I sent my husband a love email.
I read the newspaper to my wife, and it cracked her up. But she's still laughing.
What have you done for your marriage today? Make a change for the better. Need help? Go to foryourmarriage.org, a message from the Catholic Church.
They say America is the land of opportunity, but for some, life isn't so easy. Right now in America, 1 in 6 children lives below the poverty line. That's nearly 13 million children of all races, all across our country. Where do you draw the line and get involved? You can make a difference in more ways than you think. Go to povertyusa.org today, because 1 in 6 children in poverty is one too many. A message from the Catholic Campaign for Human Development.